Aloha. Welcome to the 12th Annual Energy Briefing, sponsored by the Hawaii Energy Policy Forum, the Forum. The Forum has worked hard to bring you this and other programs to advance clean energy. We are 46 strong, representing government, federal, state, and local, academia, utilities, oil and gas companies, labor, renewable energy trade associations, and environmental organizations, of course. Many of them are here today. Will the Forum members who are here please stand to be recognized for their commitment to making clean energy ubiquitous in Hawaii? Wow. All right. Thank you. All right. Good for you. A round of applause for those guys. This is not a small thing. Yeah? Is it working? Okay. All right.
Ask if they can hear you from back.
It's the 12th year the Forum has presented a legislative briefing to update the legislature and the public on how things are going and what we need to focus on in the upcoming session and in the year. Thanks to the Energy and Budget Chairs for giving us this opportunity to meet here in the legislative auditorium with all of you. We have legislators here today who care about one of the major drivers of the state, energy. It wasn't that way when we started, but the ranks of the enlightened have grown, and we will recognize them as they come in. I know only Representative Lee for now, but there are others.
There are many others.
Many others coming in soon. As in the past, we have a full agenda, and we focus on issues, challenges, opportunities for us to become energy independent. The theme of the briefing last year was change and challenge. Changes in our new governor, our new administration, our new PUC chair, our new legislators, and of course, the fluctuations in the price of oil. We had a full range of experts sharing their manao and predictions with us. After a year of transformation and hard work, we see the price of oil plummeting. This morning, $32 a barrel, with lots of oscillation to come. No need to work even harder. We need to work even harder to keep an eye on our energy goals as we go through the session. With so many priorities, other priorities on the legislative agenda, this one has to be right near the top. Now, in this second year of the biennium, we need to focus on staying the course. That's our theme, on finding and delivering solutions. To do that, we need everyone pulling together and keeping the big picture in mind, and looking at what we want, what we need, and how we can do that together. We can't take our hand off the stick, not for a moment, no matter what the markets or the political fortunes, one way or the other, take us. We have dreamt the dream of 100% renewable energy in generating electrical power, and that and community solar were big wins last session. We saw the need, but we left transportation on the burner. We did set the 100% RPS goal last year. Setting the goal is one thing, getting there is another. It's not something we do, you know, at the last minute in 2045. It's something we have to do now, every day, including today. Where are we today? We are models of solar PV. We are still working on community solar and renewable fuel local production. We have not set a target for clean energy, clean transportation, although we do have it on the books that our transportation sector is supposed to use non-fossil fuels 30% by 2030. Since coming on board, our state transportation director, Ford Fujikami, has been very busy, and we recognize his energy and commitment to making up for the lost time in clean transportation. We'll hear from him later. What do we need to do now, today? We hope to cover that. I'm excited to hear from our speakers to pave the way for us in the session and beyond. Our speakers will tell us about the current efforts on the energy scene, in the technologies, in the research, and on our entrepreneurial efforts to build the clean energy industry here in Hawaii. They also bring us the policy thinking by which we can find the right path and keep our eye on the ball and not blink or be distracted by oil, weather, or politics. Yes, distraction with politics, even here in the square building. Would you believe it? Both policymakers and the public have to be well informed about the priorities and the options and the obstacles to getting them done. What does the 2016 legislature need to do? What does it need not to do to make long-term progress on an initiative which is so critical to our state? We have to think into the future. Short-term thinking is really dangerous now. We have a full panel, and they have a lot to say, so without further ado, let's get started. You know, we wanted to leave the time for Q&A, but because the speakers needed time to inform, we are foregoing that part of our usual format. Instead, we're going to ask you to use the index cards we gave you to write your questions down. We'll have the speakers answer them and post the answers on the forum website, which is hawaiienergypolicy.org. If you want an answer sooner than that, you can include your email and send it to us that way. Stan Osterman, as in the past, where's Stan? There's Stan Osman, Brigadier General Stan Osman. He's ubiquitous. He's the state hydrogen coordinator, and he's our trusty timekeeper today. So the first thing is Representative Chris Lee. Chris, welcome. Thank you for being our opening speaker. Do I have more on? Oh, yeah. No one is more appropriate to start us off in the legislative briefing than Chris Lee, the chair of the House Committee on Energy and Environmental Protection. No pressure. Chris is no stranger to energy and to us. He's a leader, along with Senator Mike Gabbard, former chair and current vice chair of the Senate Transportation Energy Committee, who have together brought us the 100% RPS law, community solar, and other clean energy measures. A warm welcome, really warm for Chris Lee.
Thanks a lot for the very warm welcome. I can't really underscore how important this past year has been for our state, for our country, for the world, really. All eyes have been on us, not because of what we've done, but because of what we've promised that we're going to do. About 2 months ago now, I was sitting explaining exactly what we're talking about here today to a group of people that included, well, the president and the president's chief of staff and a lot of the cabinet folks that I was able to meet with while I was up there. And there are some high expectations of what we're about to do. So no pressure on all of you who are going to make this happen. But the truth is, this is exciting not just because of these goals that we've set and because of the new technology that's coming to bear, but because of what this is going to mean for us and our next generation, and the one after that, here in Hawaii and around the world. There are three things, I think, more than anything this year that come to mind when we talk about 100% renewable, when we talk about hydrogen, when we talk about all these different things that each of us has our hand in a piece of. And those things are, number one, what it is that we're going to pay and what it is that we're going to benefit from in the immediate future. Number two, how is this going to affect us here in our state at a time when we're looking out for climate adaptation, mitigation, and other things that we're now being forced as taxpayers to pay for to just survive beyond? And the third thing is, what is it going to mean for us here this year? What is it going to mean for us? What do we have to do in each of our respective roles to get us where we want to go? There are three other things I wanted to talk about very briefly. Number one, that I think is probably at the centerpiece of all of this, and you thought I was going to talk about NextEra, but I'm not. But the role of the utilities, no matter who controls them, and their evolution to a new model that allows all of us to participate in a new way, which the PUC is just beginning their due diligence on right now. How do we transition those utilities to a model of a grid operator, on which all of us, whether projects large or small, on rooftops or out in neighbor islands, can all participate and play a role? Secondly, how do we, as responsible leaders of our state, ensure that taxpayers are taken care of, not just ratepayers, but taxpayers on their end? Because we pay hundreds of millions of dollars a year on our electric bill for our public facilities and institutions. About this time last year, as I was, I think, on that side of the stage giving the same talk, we talked about, well, what are we going to do? What are those first steps going to be? And we've since come quite far. The University of Hawaii now has a statutory mandate, actually, to be generating 100% of its own power renewably by 2035. And if anyone's got the resources and expertise, the people in this room, the state of Hawaii, backing this project can help make this thing happen. We've got opportunities for microgrids, for integrating new technologies, for efficiency, all coming together to make our campuses on each island models and laboratories for what could be. And the last thing I want to talk about, which Jay highlighted briefly, was transportation, which is the real 800-pound gorilla in the room, which comprises the vast majority of our energy that we use. How do we get off of our dependence on fossil fuels there? In an industry which, compared to the electricity side of things, is still early on in its growth. How do we get to a place where we can take hydrogen technologies, EV technologies, and all these things and implement them in a meaningful, scalable way? The great thing about that time that I spent in D.C., and I was so fortunate to get to talk with folks about, as you walk into the West Wing of the White House, you walk past an EV charging station. Who would have thought of that? And also, you walk past a bike share station that is actually cordoned off from the rest of the world and is only available for White House staff because it's inside the security perimeter, but it's there nonetheless, and that makes a statement. How do we incorporate these things locally to get us to that 100% renewable goal, not just for fossil fuel use in our utilities, but for all of us collectively? That is the end goal. It's going to be a long road ahead, but as I say, if these heads and these minds come together, right, anything is possible, which I tell my colleagues, no one else believes it. The legislature has that capability, but I think we can, because this is Hawaii, and this is our future that's on the line. So the sooner I close my mouth, the less greenhouse gases I'll be spewing. So I will end there and just wish everybody a happy energy day and good luck in 2016. Thank you.
Oh, next time, okay. Dr. Sharon Moriwaki, co-chair of the forum. Can I call you Sharon?
Sharon.
Thank
Sharon.
You. Will bring us current on the forum's work in advancing clean energy. And Dr. Mike Hamnett, also co-chair of the forum. Can I call you Dr. Mike? Will tell us about the public survey we conducted to get ready for this briefing. So Sharon, you're on.
Thank you. Thanks, Jay.
A warm welcome from Sharon Moriwaki, who spends the whole year day and night. 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm telling you, I know.
Well, aloha from the Hawaii Energy Policy Forum. As Jay said, this is our 12th annual briefing, but it is the 14th year of the forum. We started as a very small group committed to knowledge-based collaboration to find smart energy solutions for a healthy, prosperous, in secure Hawaii, and that was 14 years ago. Today we have 45 members strong, and we have hundreds of people who are bringing clean energy to our state, and we are so pleased with that. In fact, we are so pleased, we often ask ourselves whether we've worked ourselves out of a job. Our job was to find those places and spaces where we should be doing something or doing more, but weren't, and to begin the conversation or the research to get something going. So we're still here. We're committed to bringing together all the perspectives to address controversial and emerging issues in energy. We want to inform, hear from, engage energy stakeholders and the public. When we first started, we were talking amongst ourselves, but today there is a larger conversation going on, and we need to have that even expand further because so much is involved in what Representative Lee said. You know, you're asked to have choices, but how do you know if you're not informed to make sound decisions, to have good choices that you can have our decision makers provide for you? Because the forum can bring research from the university, and you'll hear from some of the faculty today, and issues and knowledge from a very broad range of stakeholders. We have oil and gas companies, utilities, government, renewable energy associations, unions, and we explore, discuss, and find solutions within a broad framework on issues such as LNG, utility of the future, distributed generation, storage, clean transportation, and we've been working on that for a long time, so we're really pleased that Director Fujikami is now on board with the forum and will work closely with us as we move forward. And what we're going to hear today, climate change and climate change mitigation, all of these swirling around us, and we need to work on these big issue items and do it in a collaborative togetherness way. And because the forum is independent, we can discuss and report on any and all issues that will advance clean energy and energy self-reliance for the public benefit. We heard that government and utilities speak of choices, but unless we support development of the technologies, the infrastructure, the workers, these and the 100% renewable goals will not be achievable. They will be just a pipe dream. So the governor did sign that 100% renewable law last year, and we are moving forward, and as Representative Lee said, this helps us. So we need to do more to inform the public. Our Energy Wednesday shows, briefings such as this, our Clean Energy Day, our website, and soon the clean energy performance data will be available electronically for the total anyone in our community. We hope this briefing and other public outreach education efforts will inform, foster dialogue, and engage everyone. So please join us as we move forward, and we hope that together, as Representative Lee says, together we can, in fact, look at the big picture, look at how we might work together, and together build a better Hawaii. Thank you.
Sorry. I'm going to give you just a teaser preview of the results of a survey that was conducted, an online survey, which surveyed 598 Hawaii residents between December 28, 2015 and January 14, 2016. Links to the online survey were distributed by email to members of this group as well as others involved in energy, including legislators and public servants and the general public. The survey sought to inform and obtain input on clean energy issues. These included renewable energy goals in electricity and transportation, what could be done to achieve those goals, personal reasons that people believe that we should be pursuing clean energy goals, what respondents themselves would be willing to do, how much respondents have followed clean energy issues, and about the importance of climate change to Hawaii's energy future. The results are only representative of the opinions of the people that were surveyed, but I think there are indications that it's more representative of people involved in energy issues more generally. About 70% of the survey, so second slide, about 70% of the survey respondents said they've been regularly or actively involved in efforts to reduce Hawaii's dependence on fossil fuels. Respondents came from all four counties and ranged in age from 20 to 70. The following are just some highlights of the results of the survey. Almost 70% of survey respondents said preserving the environment and minimizing climate change and making Hawaii more energy self-sufficient were the most important reasons for pursuing clean energy. Slide three. Over 73% of respondents said that they were personally willing to reduce their daily use of fossil fuels, and over 78% said they were willing to support construction of renewable energy projects on their islands and in their neighborhoods. Over 46% said they support higher taxes on fossil fuels if that money was used to support the further development of renewable energy. A little more than half of the respondents did not take advantage of renewable energy tax credits. Of those that did, 60% got credits for rooftop solar or PV. Only about 6% for transportation. When asked about clean energy goals for transportation, 85% advocated setting clean energy goals for transportation. Only about a third of respondents thought that the goals were 100% were too ambitious, 100% by 2045. To reach the current clean energy goal of 30% for transportation, 30% not said non-fossil fuels for transportation, almost 80% advocated expanding non-fossil fuel use in public transportation. Next slide. Most respondents have been following global climate change discussions, with only about 12% stating that they had not been following the issue. Over half have been following the issue on a regular basis or have been actively involved in discussions of climate change. Almost 70% of the respondents said climate change is important or very important to Hawaii's clean energy future. Less than 3% said it wasn't important at all. The forum began this process because we know we've been kind of talking to ourselves, and we were trying to sort of expand our understanding of what people thought about what we're on about here. In the future, we believe that a random sample statewide household survey would be even more instructive to get an idea of what those that are not involved in insider baseball think about these issues. And the results of the survey will be on the web probably by the end of the month. These are just some of the highlights of what came out of the survey. Thank you.
License to tell a short story.
So granted.
Thank you. You know, in the 80s, my firm is a downtown real estate business firm. And one of our clients came to us and said, what do you think about, you know, stopping smoking in public places? So I said, yeah, we can do that. How do we do it? You know, and there's a parallel here between getting people excited about clean energy and energy efficiency. So what happened is we went around, and the management of these buildings went around, and they talked to people, and they changed the rules in the buildings, and they, you know, dealt with anybody. There were a bunch of lawyers, may I use that expression, who felt that there was an inherent right to smoke. Okay, we had to deal with that. But ultimately, one building after another fell on a voluntary basis, building by building, and they became no-smoke buildings. And then the city council got involved, the state legislature got involved, government got involved, and it became, you know, total. And so now downtown is pretty much a non-smoking area. Everyone buys in. Everyone is on board. We have had a transformation on that issue. There is no smoking down. You know, go on an elevator in Bishop Square one day and light up a cigarette in front of other people and see what I mean. Nobody will tolerate that. It doesn't matter what the law is, they will not tolerate smoking in their presence. So that was a transformation. We have a transformation here. And, you know, and there'll come a time when, you know, you don't have energy efficiency in your house. You know, you don't use clean energy. What's wrong with you? You know, and when we get to that point, I think we'll be well closer to 2045. Just a thought. Anyway, let me introduce the segments. We usually give you updates from the field, but this year we want to focus on the big picture policy issues and challenges that might affect our 100% renewable goal in electric generation. This year, we are pleased that we have new and strong leadership in the State Department of Transportation that will make the changes we've been waiting for. We will also cover global climate change issues for Hawaii that emerged from COP21. These are not small issues. Then we have a third panel to help us together get together through integration, innovation, cooperation, and partnership. So to start us off with the global perspective and how it impacts us, pleased to have the Associate Dean of UH School of Earth Sciences and Technology, Chip Fletcher. He's here, I know he's here, who will share his expertise and educate us on the global and local climate trends and how they are impacting our state. He was on our Energy Wednesday show last week to discuss this huge and urgent issue. Welcome to the program, Chip. Well, why don't you take a seat at the table? Yeah. Wait. I'll sit. Okay. I'll sit there and watch you. No, you take this.
Do I start talking now?
Yeah. Now you start talking. In a minute, I'll
do this. First slide. There we go. Okay. So here is the latest data on 130 years of changing air temperature. When I show my students this, I ask them to watch for patterns, and the patterns I hope that they observe are that there's change taking place that's spatially variable and that's temporally variable. In other words, no single place on the planet is warming or cooling simultaneously, and one year after another, the temperature might be up, it might be down, but overall, there's a long-term trend that clearly indicates that the planet is warming. 2015 has just ended, and yesterday NOAA and NASA announced that it set a new record. In fact, it smashed records for warming. Right up here is, in fact, let's look over here. Here is the temperature of 2015. Here are the temperature rankings of the last 17 years. And you can see that there's almost a full third of a degree warmer that has been achieved by 2015 compared to previous years. So this is both data from NOAA and from NASA. It was an incredibly warm year, and for reasons I can't go into here, there is fear that we are actually entering a new phase of something that's known as the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, which may engender
much stronger warming year after year as we move forward over the next decade or more than we have seen in the past decade or two. So how does this climate change, which is a global problem, track down to our state, Hawaii? Sea level rise is one impact resulting from global climate change. Heat waves, changing precipitation patterns, changing storminess, ocean acidification and warming, and ecosystem threats. And I'm going to work quickly through each of these over the next couple of minutes. Sea level rise arrives in several different forms. NASA last month announced that given what we know now about how the ocean expands as it warms and how ice sheets and glaciers are adding water to the seas, it's pretty certain that we are locked into at least 3 feet of sea level rise and probably more. So this is a good number to begin to model the impacts of future sea level rise along our shorelines. Sea level rise arrives at our doorstep in several ways. There's coastal erosion, which accelerates with sea level rise. There's wave flooding. The large waves of the year will flood further into the land. There's groundwater inundation, which rises. The groundwater table rises as the sea level rises because they're connected. Drainage failure. Our drainage system gets clogged up at high tide already in our lowest areas of Mapunapuna and Iwilei and certain parts of Waikiki. And if it happens to rain at that point during high tide, there's no place for that runoff to go. Our drainage infrastructure is being overwhelmed by sea level rise slowly. And this is happening in Miami Beach, worse than anywhere else in the world. Hurricane and tsunami vulnerability increase as sea level rises. So here is a model of Eva Beach. There's Pearl Harbor entrance over here. And what we see in green is what's known as groundwater inundation. These are areas where the water table is going to rise and create new wetlands in what was previously dry land as sea level rises. And here is marine inundation. This is static water from the ocean flooding onto the land over the coastline. Two completely different forms of flooding that are going to begin to take place. And this is under 3 feet of sea level rise, again, the projection for the end of the century. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is projecting about 3 feet of sea level rise towards the end of this century. Here's the same sort of model for the urban core. Notice Waikiki, Kaka'ako, Mo'ili'ili. These areas are all former wetlands. They're all filled, and they're all very low. And so they're vulnerable to this type of flooding. This is our model of wave flooding with a south swell, a typical south swell that occurs off of Eva Beach in the typical summertime with 3 feet of sea level rise. And you can see that we have, if you look at the entire Eva coast, our model indicates hundreds of homes are flooded temporarily by wave overwash across the shoreline. Now, if your house is built up on post and pier, that water will run underneath and it shouldn't do too much damage. But unfortunately, very few of our houses are built that way. Instead, our houses are built slab on grade. And when a wave runs into the first floor of your house, you've got total devastation to the house. So I think one of the things we need to do to adapt to this problem is to change our building codes. We also have a model of coastal erosion, and you can see these light lines here. This is our model of erosion under 3 feet of sea level rise. That red line is by the end of the century. This represents permanent land loss versus the wave inundation, which represents temporary wave flooding. Two different forms of a problem, each needing their own adaptation. Another problem we're going to have in Hawaii, and in fact it's already started, is heat waves. Earth has broken monthly heat records 34 times just in the last 15 years. The last cold record that was broken was in 1916, and the coldest year on record was in 1911. Heat waves are the most lethal form of climate impact. 9 of the 10 deadliest heat waves in history have occurred in the last 15 years, and we have about 140,000 deaths worldwide over that period due to heat waves. Extremely high temperatures observed once in 20 years are now projected to occur every 2 to 4 years by mid-century. Record highs are now more than twice as likely to occur as record lows. And one example was just this past summer. We had 2,400 deaths in India when temperatures soared to 120 degrees and stayed there for weeks. One reason that heat waves are so deadly is because they tend to settle in and stay, and this is because of large meanders in the jet stream. And the jet stream is behaving very differently than it used to because of the warming that's taking place. This is from Civil Beat in 2014, 2 years ago. HECO asks Oahu customers to cut back on electricity to avoid power outages. They did the same thing in September and August of 2015. Hilo set a record high at this date of 93 degrees, breaking an old record of 1987. And HECO had to ask customers to conserve power during peak hours because muggy conditions increase the demand for power. So we're all turning on our air conditioning when we go home at night, and we tend to leave it running all night long. And this is a new phenomenon. This is an area of our energy that does not get discussed enough. As we are converting to renewable energy, we also need to armor the grid for these high demand periods, because when we have a blackout, if you're stuck in a 30-story condo tower and you can't use the elevator and there's no air conditioning, and you're elderly or very young or ill, you can't go down the stairs. This is how heat waves turn fatal. Changing precipitation. Global drought has increased 10%. Global extreme rainfall has increased 12%. So this is the irony of global warming, is when it rains, it's cats and dogs, and then you have long periods of drought in between. This is going to affect our food, and we're at the end of the food supply line here in Hawaii. As an example, global wheat currently provides 20% of all human protein worldwide. Rising CO2 actually decreases the nutrient and protein content of wheat. Population growth by 2050 is going to increase our demand for wheat by 60%, and yet actual yield is going to decline by 15% between the drought, the intense rainfall, and the decreasing nutrition. And right now, for this and other reasons, food prices are projected to double just in the next 15 years. I think that while we have a Hawaii renewable energy policy, and as great as that is, we should also have a Hawaii food policy, a sustainable food policy, because we need to start investing in growing our own food. People around the rest of the world who ship their food to us are going to get first dibs on that food, and we're going to be paying far more than double as this plays out. Local food production is critical. It's dependent on irrigation. And in Hawaii, future rainfall patterns are still unclear, but models are converging on some aspects. It's looking like there's going to be decreased winter rainfall in dry areas, longer and drier dry seasons in Hawaii, greater demand on irrigation, and increased precipitation in some areas. So net, we may have as much water available, but getting water from where the increased precipitation is to where we need it is going to require a new look at how we engineer our water distribution system. Changing storminess. It's projected that we will have a localized increase in rain intensity, and we see that in some places. And you may have noticed this past September and October when we had some very strong downpours. Tropical cyclone paths are shifting to the north, and increased rainfall and wind speed associated with tropical cyclones is occurring. That's been observed. We also are projected to have a greater frequency of El Nino years as we move forward. This past year, we had 15 tropical cyclones, and the average, historic average, is 4 to 5, and the previous record was 11 in 1992 and 1994. This is the track of tropical cyclones. Hawaii is right there. We're in a beautifully unique location where we have not been hit previously by as many hurricanes as many other locations. But this track is shifting to the north. It's been observed that the tropics are expanding, and the zone of highest winds in tropical cyclones are shifting towards the poles. This is going to put these hurricanes that typically pass to our south, right, we're going to be right in their bullseye. They're going to be migrating towards us from the east. And the folks at the National Weather Service put together this bit of art. Here are the Hawaiian Islands, and these are the tropical cyclones that we had this past year. For some magical reason, none of them hit us. How long is that going to hold? We can keep our fingers crossed. Ocean acidification and warming is going to lead to increased coral bleaching, and you've all paid attention to the news. We've had extreme bleaching last year and this year around Hawaii. This results in decreased calcification among the entire marine ecosystem. And reefs are already stressed in Hawaii by overfishing and pollution. Combined, these impacts favor algal-dominated reefs. So we're going to be seeing a shift from these beautiful coral-dominated reefs to ones that are dominated by algae with a lack of coral. Here we are at 2 degrees C, which was the target for Paris. So we're on track. In fact, the world is hoping to get to this level. We need to relieve the stressors that are on our reefs right now, which is pollution and overfishing. Ecosystem threats. We're now entering a new climate envelope. Historically, the hottest years are going to be colder than future cold snaps. Future cold snaps will be hotter than historic heat waves. We're moving into a whole new climate envelope, which opens the door for invasive species. Our ecosystems are stressed because of this, and rainfall is also changing around the state. This is inviting conditions for invasive species and the spread of tropical diseases. Here's a photo of three species, one of which is tearing down the entire canopy here, a climbing vine. So I'll end with this. What does the future hold? Just look at 2015. I think this past year was a great example of what we can expect in the future. The models project more El Niños in the future, and they're projecting stronger El Niños. We had a very strong El Niño this year. 2015 is going to be symptomatic of the future. More tropical cyclones, more extremely hot days straining our power system, more heavy rain events overwhelming the drainage system, more coastal erosion and wave impacts, invasive species, expensive food, hurricane impacts, and tropical diseases. Are you depressed yet? We are not helpless. We can anticipate this, we can adjust our human systems, and we can adapt. There are plenty of adaptation options. I'll end with that. Thank you very much.
Yes, we are depressed. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
You know, it sounds more drear anytime anybody talks about it. But you know, God bless, we have SOWEST here. And it's a wonderful treasure that we have, the School of Ocean Earth Science and Technology, and the Hawaii Institute of Geophysics and Planetology, and Seymour, the Center for Microbial Oceanography, research and education, because they can tell us what's going on. They can tell us, they can flesh out what Chip was saying, and the result is that we can build that into our planning, government planning, private industry planning, and energy planning, okay? So it's very important. Okay, now we're going to hear from Ben Sullivan, hearing all that is happening to us and wondering whether we have any control over it. We have asked Ben Sullivan, who's an advocate for mitigating, not merely adapting to climate change. Ben is the Energy and Sustainability Coordinator for Kauai. He's a very big thinker. He's also a very big person. And he will help us understand what we can do to address the climate change challenges we are now facing. And Representative Gene Ward is here. Welcome, Professor Gene Ward. Where are you? Thank you for coming down. Have a seat. Enjoy. I mean, it's hard to enjoy climate change, but a warm welcome for Ben Sullivan. Yeah, come this way, walk this way.
Yeah, let's see if we can get this thing up here. Is that working? Can you guys hear me? I could kick the platform aside. We'll go with what we got. Okay, first off, thank you to Sharon and Jay and Hawaii Energy Policy Forum for, I guess, sticking me up here and let me try to talk to you guys about this. This is a tough subject, and I think you just saw that with Dr. Fletcher, who's really one of the best communicators on you know, what things look like in Hawaii. So thanks, Dr. Fletcher. You know, it certainly is staring us in the face, is climate change right here in Hawaii. Normally, I get to come up here and brag about all the great things happening on Kauai. I work for Mayor Bernard Cavallo over there, and we really have some exciting stuff happening with KUC And with ground transportation, you know, working with Ford and his group and really making some great things happen. Today, it's a different conversation. So really, what we're talking about today is, you know, we've had a story on climate change for a long time in clean energy. And that story has been climate change is a problem. We're going to move towards clean energy. And that's what we'll do. I want to put forward to you guys that I think that's about as sophisticated as the conversation has been for a pretty long time. I think we understand very clearly that, you know, greenhouse gas is emissions. I mean, the source of emissions in greenhouse gas is fossil fuel use in Hawaii, and that's all clear, and we have the data very well down. And in fact, we have made, as everyone has commented already today, amazing progress in the electricity sector. Amazing progress. You know, people are really looking at us as a model, and it's tremendously exciting. But I think sometimes we forget like the bigger picture, and so that's what this discussion is going to be about. We're gonna get into later some of those conversations about how well we're doing, and I think we're gonna hear from folks that really understand, you know, getting to 100% clean energy. And imagine that we're having a serious conversation about getting to 100% clean energy in our grid. You know, that's what my old high school football coach used to call it, you know, a high class problem. I think it's great that we're doing that. I think it's really exciting. And then with transportation, progress is not quite as far along, but it is moving. And again, with HDOT really taking the lead and a tremendous amount of people working in a bunch of different directions, it's very exciting. I think with transportation, we all recognize that maybe we don't have the same level of mandate, and there's a question as to whether we can benefit from that. You know, we're not as clear on the goals. We have lots of things we might do, and we might do them next year. We might do them 5 years from now. We're not sure what the driver is, but you know, you just heard from Dr. Fletcher, and certainly the question becomes, is climate one of those drivers? Let me see if I can get this guy to work. Is it the top button? Oh, I'm supposed to point it over there, the actual device. There we go. Okay. So this is a very brief timeline on some of the very, you know, the real large policy events that have happened in Hawaii. I'm hoping I can get a show of hands for those who participated in the 1998 climate change the state climate action plan. Climate Change Action Plan, anybody here? Yeah, Mike? I know there's some others. Yeah, thank you. Dr. Fletcher, I'm sure there's more, because actually there's a long list of people that contributed. So back in 1998, there was a really, really forward-thinking group of people who talked about this issue and brought it forward for the state and did our first Climate Change Action Plan. And they, you know, there's a quote up there about what, you know, one of the things they identified, but again, tremendous work very early on. It was clear to them that, hey, you know, fossil fuel use is where it's at. We really have a problem when it comes to tourism, but we're gonna really go places with regards to electricity and ground transportation. Let me see here. I'm just gonna go ahead and skip ahead a decade. So you skip ahead a whole decade, and I'll just go ahead and say myself personally, I'm okay with skipping that decade. You know, if you recall, that was George Bush and tax credits for really big cars. So as an energy guy, I didn't miss a lot if we just pass right over that. We had Act 234, which was another huge step forward, right? I mean, the state came out as one of the early states to say we're gonna do something about mitigating our greenhouse gas, and as many of you know well, that was we're gonna reduce our greenhouse gas emissions to 1990 levels by 2020. You know, the State Department of Health and the Clean Air Branch has done tremendous work in setting up the rules and actually moving on that, and it's clear to most people involved we're going to get there, and that's great. So you got those two pieces, and then you got HCEI, which obviously just followed a year after. One of the things I really want to get into here is and I'll get into it in a minute, but you know, again, climate change was mentioned in the messaging with HCEI. I mean, everybody remembers, right? It's kind of like one of those things that we say, you know, we're doing this for the economy, we're doing this for climate change, we're doing this for energy security. There's this whole kind of litany of things we go through when we talk about clean energy. But we didn't ever get real specific about, you know, how important is it, and are there measurable results with regards to climate change and mitigation that we're trying to achieve? You know, finally, we have last year's knuckle bump by our two great legislators, Chris Lee and Senator Gabbard. Is Senator Gabbard here yet? No? Okay. So anyway, they're behind, I don't know if you can make out that image on the far right there, but they're behind Governor Ige at the signing of the big one, which is 100% clean energy by 2045. So here's the questions that I put on the table for us to think about today. Apologies in advance for those of you who feel like you already have a command of these issues. In my experience, it's been somewhat rare, as I've said before, in past conversations that we've addressed these specific questions regarding climate change. When we first started down this road, it was largely unnecessary, as we talked about before. You know, we had no progress back in 2008, or relatively little progress in clean energy. So we didn't need to have specific metrics as to how far we're going to get and why. There was a million reasons. You know, we had oil over $100 a barrel bleeding the economy. We had wars in foreign countries that were contentious and all about, in many cases, oil. We had a lot of reasons for thinking about moving back to clean energy. We also had very limited public understanding on climate change. You know, this was just a couple of years from the time when Al Gore stood up and woke the country up. I mean, everybody remembers, you know, I guess, at least from my generation, I know there's people that have been on this issue forever, and I know it's been understood forever, but that was kind of the national moment where people said, okay, we get this. This is something, and it's really important. But I guess what I want to say to you guys is I'm not sure if we ever took it any farther. We just said, okay, again, climate change is bad. We have to do something about it, and it was a very abstract thing. Again, fast forwarding a decade, here we are today. We have cheap domestic oil and gas. We have a rebounding economy, and that gas is and oil is being produced here in the U.S. Price is way down. Let me see. You know, the question we have to ask ourselves, is there a risk? Is there a risk of stalling out here? I mean, you know, we've had a much bigger room full of people in the past, and I'm not saying that's the only measure. But certainly, there was a lot more enthusiasm for clean energy when oil was north of $100 a barrel than perhaps there is today. You know, in fact, we can look at the national trends that have happened recently with regards to vehicles, and we've seen that fleet efficiency standards and new vehicle purchases have started to kind of come back down again. You know, those SUVs are starting to look attractive. So, you know, what's the difference? What's the difference today? So one thing we do have going for us today with regards to climate change and mitigation is we finally have the arrival of global leadership. So, you know, getting to the punchline, perhaps the most significant change, again, between today and 2008 is we have every country on the planet essentially agreeing to where we need to get. And so, you know, this is a little bit wonky as are some of my other slides, but basically, what you got here is what Dr. Fletcher talked about. You know, we are already locked into a significant amount of global warming. We're already locked into a significant amount of impacts, and we're going to have to deal with those. But we do have a fundamental choice here. We have, you know, we can do a little bit, and we can get a lot of temperature change, or we can do a lot and get a little bit of temperature change. And I think that one of the key things when you look at this is okay, remember, in Paris, and you know, we've known this for a long time, but in Paris, we really ratified this notion that 2 degrees is the threshold, that we're willing, you know, we've got to stop it beyond 2 degrees. The scientists have a clear understanding. There is really no guarantee whatsoever that above 2 degrees, we don't hit all kinds of tipping points. And in fact, Dr. Fletcher was talking about the fact that maybe we already are going to hit those tipping points. You know, the other thing, and I think this is where we need to go, is to understand the sophistication and the level of detail that the science can give us. So, On the left, again, you're looking at the 2-degree scenario, and that corresponds to what they call the representative concentration pathway from the IPCC, which is a lot of modeling that indicates, okay, what level of carbon dioxide can we put out over the next several decades, and what's the resultant temperature? And then how does that translate, most importantly, into, you know, our reduction of greenhouse gases from today's baseline? So if you start looking at some of those numbers, you know, business as usual just sends us through the roof, and I don't think anyone wants to leave the planet to our kids like that. And you know, let's be candid about that. This is not easy, but these measures are crazy and difficult to get at. But this is what the science is telling us. They're saying 40% to 70% global decrease in carbon dioxide emissions by 2050. I mean, you know, that it's a stunning amount of reduction. And then you look at, you know, you go to 2100 and they're basically saying we have to be carbon neutral or carbon negative. So I guess what I would love for Hawaii Energy Policy Forum to do and for the legislators to do is to talk about this and to tell these people that they're crazy if they think so, or to come on board and say, this is actually the mark we need to set. So yes, we've got a great start in clean energy. yes, we're doing great things on the grid, but we got to look at the whole system, because that's where we have to get. And regardless of, you know, how hard it might seem, that's the mark we're trying to achieve. So one of the questions that often comes up when you talk about emissions reductions in Hawaii, and I think, you know, understanding the size of the challenge we have in adaptation, it's easy why this is the case. But people go to this notion of, do Hawaii emissions even matter? We are tiny. You know, these statistics here, and just give you a brief explanation, the chart horizontally along the bottom shows the world's biggest emitters by country, per year. And the figures aren't so important right now. I'm just trying to give you a relative difference. You know, China's number one, as we all know. We're number two, and you can go on down the list. Interestingly, when you look at this vertical orientation, this other graph, what we're looking at there is per capita emissions. And so China is way down the list. You see Canada number one, and again, United States number two. So you know, is the right question, you know, do Hawaii emissions even matter? Or is the right question, you know, do our emissions as people even matter? Emissions come from people, as we all know. They don't come from countries, right? It's all of our activities that lead to these emissions. So if we don't like what we saw on the previous slides, then the obvious thing to do is to say, we have to emit less carbon. By the way, we did do a survey on this as well. I'm gonna just share with you guys that we made a total rookie mistake, and this was my fault. I'll take all the blame for it. We issued a survey at the same time as another survey from the same organization. Don't ever do that. Because people think they already responded, and you end up with a pretty challenging environment. So, should Hawaii climate policy align with U.S. policy? So, this right here is what the United States contributed to the Paris Accord last December. This was their submittal, and as many of you probably know, the United States intends to achieve an economy-wide target of reducing its greenhouse gas emissions by 26% to 28%. By 2025, and obviously making the best efforts to actually hit 28%. So, but what was not in the headlines, but what is represented up here, is that we actually, you know, that thing is on a very specific path that associates with an 80% reduction by 2050. So again, aligning to those RCP goals, that the United States is saying, we're a developed country, we've been one of the worst emitters all the way along. We actually have to reduce our emissions more than developing countries by 2050. So if you thought it was intimidating to look at the data on the previous slide, here we are, and you know, who thinks we can do this? I mean, how about a show of hands for reducing our emissions by 80% by 2050? I'm talking about, like, actually reducing, not relative, not this kind of percentage and assuming growth, but we're talking about total emissions. So on, with a baseline of, say, you know, 2005. I saw a couple hands go up, but you know, obviously for people who work on the policy and work on the technology, that is a very, very intimidating mark. But you know, that's what it is. This is, we again, let's engage on this conversation. Let somebody sit here and refute this or say that, no, that's not our goal, that's not where we need to be. Okay, so No presentation on climate change in Hawaii would be complete without an image of an outrigger canoe. But give me a minute, and I'm gonna, in all seriousness, I'm gonna get back to that. But first, let's take another look at U.S. emissions. So what you see here is East and West Coast states. It's basically a heat map that shows the relative emissions per capita in all these states that I'm showing. So you can see, I think we put Oahu right there in the middle, right about in Nebraska. So, not sure if everybody's gonna be too happy about that, but just for visual purposes, we can live with it. On one end of the scale, we have what we'll call the red states, and those guys are doing about 18 tons per person per year on average. And then way down on the other end of the scale, we have 5 tons per person per year. It seems impossibly low, and actually it's the District of Columbia, and I'm thinking to myself, all the hot air, right? And they're at 5 tons per person per year. It doesn't make any sense to me. Of course, this doesn't tell the whole story. You know, of course, there's nuances to each individual location. There's hydropower in the Northwest, and there's, you know, coal here, and there's this kind of fuel there. And so, you know, and then all kinds of other issues that come into play in this conversation. But I think the important thing to do is that, you know, one of the myths or one of the things you hear when you talk about mitigation in Hawaii, again, is, hey, you know, our emissions are really a lot lower than everyone else's. Well, guess what? They're really not. You know, there's we put out a lot of carbon dioxide. And I think most importantly, when you think about this, you know, how am I doing? Pow! Oh, man! Okay, give me 1 minute to just zip, and I'll do that. I had no idea. I practiced this, and I thought I had way more time. It's 15 minutes, right? What happened? Okay. So we're the only state in the U.S. surrounded by the ocean. We're the state with the strongest cultural connection to our fellow Pacific Islanders, who in some cases are losing their homes. So does it matter that we emit more than everyone else? You know, that's a question for the legislature. That's a question for the people of Hawaii. I don't know the answer, but, you know, does it matter is a really important question. This is going to take just two more seconds, a couple more slides. Here's cities that are in our class. These are world-class cities and world-class locations that are taking the bull by the horns with regards to electricity and clean energy. These are the kind of places that they're having similar goals to our 100% clean energy, and that they are all making progress as well. So this comes from the Carbon Neutral Cities Alliance, and they recently published this framework, which I'm referencing here on the top. So you see all these different cities and all their various commitments. And I know it's a little bit hard to read, but one of the things I really want to point out here is that these cities, they have all one thing in common that we are missing, and that is, they certainly are moving to clean energy and renewable energy, but they all are driven by greenhouse gas reduction. So they don't just focus on electricity. They're focused on transportation. They're focused on agriculture. They're focused on consumption of consumer goods. They're focused on all kinds of facets of their communities, and they're doing it to reduce their greenhouse gas impact, and they're actually having a significant amount of success. Last slide. So should we reset our greenhouse gas goals for the state? You know, should we be really visiting this conversation again, asking ourselves, are we doing enough? Can we benefit from an aggressive clean energy goal in ground transportation? You know, certainly we have in electricity. Do we want to be leaders in transportation? I think we do. And does it matter to have this goal? Is it useful to us? It is definitely, in my view, useful to us. It's not gonna do anything by itself, and it's, you know, certainly appreciate the view of the state. Let's not just throw out more goals, but there's a reason for putting this goal forward. It's not just because it feels good. It's because we have an obligation, a responsibility. It's an opportunity. And then finally, you know, we can do this, and there's tremendous benefit. So you're going to hear from people later on who are going to talk about the huge economic potential of making these shifts. We're already there in electricity. We can do it in transportation. We can do it in tourism. But we got to start having the conversation. So I'm supposed to be done a while ago. I apologize. Thank you very much.
God, that's important. It's obvious climate change has to be built into all our state policy. Okay, the forum is really very pleased that we can tackle clean energy transportation this year. The forum began its quest for energy efficient transportation strategy in 2007. And if you recall, that was the focus of our 2013 Clean Energy Day. So we're delighted to see our new state transportation director, Ford Fujikami, has adopted this issue and is so energetic and committed about it. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce Director Ford Fujikami, who will tell us what he sees on the horizon for clean and sustainable transportation. Know that he is in charge of all forms of our state's transportation, air, harbors, highways. We also want to thank him for taking the time to be with us. And in fact, he has a meeting at 3 p.m. So he may have to leave early. Mahalo, Ford. Thanks for coming. A warm welcome to Ford Fujikami.
Sorry, let me get set up real quick here. Put my name up here. Got my buzzer. You know, first of all, clean energy. You know, it's a term that I learned when I came on board with Governor Ige in 2015. Sorry, you know, when you're having fun, time goes by so quickly. And what it was is that Governor and I, Louis Salaverria, who's in the back, we attended the Women in Renewable Energy. And during that breakfast conference, Governor announced that Ford was going to take a lead on clean energy as it related to the Department of Transportation, which is great. Unfortunately, I didn't know anything about clean energy. So it became a real hard challenge for me. One of the biggest challenges was that I couldn't figure out why my predecessors never got involved with clean energy. And I found out real quickly, it's a lot of hard work. It's damn hard. And we didn't have the staffing, we didn't have the ability to go ahead and take this on. But that being said, Governor asked me to do it, I was gonna do it, And with the assistance of my special assistant who's back there, David Rodriguez, I think we've done a hell of a job in moving this thing forward. But that being said, I attended my first Hawaii Clean Energy Initiative meeting, and at the door, they were passing out this Hawaii 2015 Energy Report Card done by Blue Planet. And this is what I saw. Transportation D-. Right under the D-, I don't know if you see it, but it says previously D-. And then it also said it was a three-year study. I went online and I tried to look for the third year. Fortunately, I couldn't find it. But I'm pretty sure it would have said D- as well. So what I did is I called Shem. And actually, I ran into him at a conference, and I told Shem, you know, what am I doing wrong? What can we do? And, you know, and I appreciate basically the email he sent me, and I'm going to read it to you so you fully understand. He said, to be clear, the grade for the transportation sector is not aimed at any one department or entity, but is based on a comparison between the actual fossil use used in transportation against a target trend line that would eliminate fossil fuel use by 2040. So I felt a little bit better. It wasn't about me, it wasn't about the DOT. Basically, it was about anybody who was involved in transportation. If fuel usage was below the target line, or even if the fuel use was above the target line but decreasing, the transportation sector would receive a more favorable score. Shem, thanks for that. That kept the motivation going. It wasn't about the D-, it was about, you know what, it's you, it's everybody that's in this room, and that's how we're going to accomplish our goal, by working together. First thing we did, this is our mission statement at the DOT. It's been the mission statement probably for the last 50 years, I don't know how long. What we did is that we put in the term or the word sustainable intermodal transportation. I think that's key. Everything that we do now in the future as it relates to the Department of Transportation is about sustainable intermodal transportation. It's not just about transportation itself. That being said, we've done a lot of work when it comes to surface transportation. We've developed the transportation sustainable forum. We've attended the Hawaii Clean Energy Initiative. We're part of the Hawaii Energy Policy Forum. But we've done other things, and these are the things that I want to talk about today. One of the biggest things that we've done is that we've actually gone through the Energy Savings Performance Contract. This is HRS 3641, which enables a lot of departments to go ahead and do energy savings. And from the savings, you can do deferred maintenance and other programs. As you can see from this slide, we are saving about 1 billion kilowatt hours at the airports, about 61 million at the harbors, and about 222 million at highways. And it's going to be very important. And you can see the dollar savings associated with that. The investment on our part, $150 million at the airport, it was the largest, and Mark will verify that, the largest ESPC done in the country by almost five times. An average ESPC basically is only about $30 million. We did one that was $150 million because we weren't afraid to literally pull the trigger and say, let's move on, let's make a statement. And now we're doing the highways and we're doing the harbors with high mast lightings. Basically how we did this, it was through LED retrofit lights. We did high efficiency air controlled ventilation, chiller plant optimization, high efficiency electrical transformers, photovoltaic, and building automation systems and smart controls. The smart controls are gonna be the key. You know, I think every night if you guys watch the news, they always show Honolulu Harbor and how bright it's lit up. When we're done with that project with our smart controls, if anybody is not working at the harbors, we're going to be able to lower that down so it won't be so bright. So the shipping companies are going to save money, and we're going to save energy is what it comes down to. I think that's a huge success as we move forward. These are some of the things that it transpired to. Building lighting, we changed about 84,000 light fixtures. 74,000 was just at the airport system alone. We went from approximately 645 different types of light fixtures down to 90. Can you imagine the inventory when it comes to my light bulbs now? What a difference it makes. High mass lightings at the harbors is about 2,346. Highway lighting about 21,000. We did some AC air systems, equipment replacement, variable frequency drives, which are very, very important. And again, smart controls on those as well. And of course, we did some chill water upgrades and some valve replacements. Again, adding some smart controls to our chill waters so that the air conditioners are not going to be running when they're not supposed to be running. We added about 12,888 photovoltaic panels, three airports. And I think you asked why only three airports. It's because of the fact that we already had PV on some of the other airport systems, and that's the reason why we only did three, eight harbors and four of our highway locations. This slide is probably the biggest. As you can take a look at it, environmental impact and benefits on the project benefits, it translated to about 9,000 jobs, about $1 billion worth of economic development, $591 million in savings to the DOT, and about 40,599 metric tons of CO2 saved annually. And that goes to the climate change that we just talked about. As far as the carbon equivalents, again, about 1,491,000 trees planted over a 10-year period. You know, I think the outdoor soaker would love that in terms of us doing this so that we don't have to do some of the things necessary in terms of getting this thing done. We also reduce emissions equivalent to 10,656 passenger vehicles, electricity used by about 9,600 homes for 1 year. And again, the reduction of 117,000 barrels of oil a year. I think that's a great, great program. And again, it was a program that was always in the system. It was always on the state records. One of the things that we also did is I issued the carbon emissions, basically reduction policy. And we kind of talked to the entire airport system. Honolulu International Airport, basically, of course, is our largest. It's the fourth largest international airport in the, as far as activity in the United States. What we did here is that we issued this, and then we went to the airlines, Airport Council International North America. They have divisions in Europe, Asia, and such. And we said that we wanted to apply for the airport carbon accreditation certification. We did some work with them last year. November 30th of this year, they actually issued us a certificate for level one, and hopefully we'll get the level two accreditation in a couple of months. We are only one, Honolulu International Airport is only one of 10 airports in the entire North America that has this accreditation. And that's because of the staff at the airport put it to their mind that they wanted to do this, they wanted to achieve this. And one of the reasons why is because of the energy savings program that we're doing there. And I think that helped a lot. But these are some of the things that we're doing to try to achieve our goals. Probably the biggest thing, and I know everybody's been talking about it, and I think Shem's gonna love this. On Tuesday of this week, we actually launched the Hawaii DOT mileage-based uses fee feasibility study. I know Blue Planet introduced the bill. We've been working on this for quite some time, Shem, just so that you know. Unfortunately, I didn't want to speak to it because of the fact that I hadn't selected a contractor, I hadn't done a lot of things. We have been participating with Oregon, California. We've been contributing money to their programs. We have all their data. We have all their information. Now it's time for us to move forward. And what we did is that we hired this consulting firm. They're going to come in. They already did come in, like I said, on Tuesday. They've been here. They're still here. They're working with us. And what we're going to do is that we're going to come up with a feasibility study that what makes best sense for the state of Hawaii when it comes to, and we're not going to use vehicle miles traveled. They told me don't use that term anymore. Use miles, mileage-based user fee. So that's the term that we're going to be using. So hopefully, once that study is done, once we do a presentation to this committee, we're going to be able to move forward. With that being said, thank you very much. I apologize. I got to run off. I have another meeting. But again, thanks for all your support. I haven't been able to get to where I am today without the support of each and every one of you in this room, some of you more than others, but everything that you do, again, is an accomplishment for all of us. And I think that being said, I'm very glad to be part of the committee. Thanks.
Thank you, Ford. I have a dream of a bunch of people in an elevator in Bishop Square, and one guy in the back turns to the other and says, I heard you got a new car. What kind of car it was? And he says, it's a fossil fuel car. And everybody in the elevator turns around, gives him a stink eye. You know, that's the way it's going to happen. Do you want to take a break? Okay. Okay, although we are a small group of islands in the middle of the vast Pacific, we're connected to and dependent on and led by the efforts of our counties, and especially since they are on the front line in mobility, transportation between and within their shorelines. Mark Garrity is from the city and county of Honolulu, who knows firsthand. He's going to tell us about the challenges of moving the city and county to clean transportation, and he will also report on other counties. Mark Garrity, a warm welcome for Mark Garrity.
Thank you, Jay. And I don't know if Director Fujigami is still here, but we really appreciate the efforts of the State Department of Transportation and the leadership of Ford and David Rodriguez and his deputy Ed Sniffen from Highways. They're a great group of people, and we really are thankful that Governor Ige appointed those people to work on this. And I think we're all going to appreciate the efforts that they're putting forth. My name is Mark Garrity. I'm the Deputy Director of the City and County of Honolulu Department of Transportation Services. And I'm going to talk about the efforts that the City and County of Honolulu are making. I'm sorry, I'm not going to actually mention much about the other counties, although I know that the other counties are making some good strides, and especially Kauai. But maybe I'll let them talk at their own another time. I do want to talk about some of the things that we are doing. And there's a two-pronged approach that we are making. And that is to make our vehicles, the things that we have control over, greener, that the city and county has purchases on a regular basis, uses fuel for, the things that we need to do to provide all those services that the city and county provides. And then the second is to try to make trips greener. That is trying to actually encourage people to use modes themselves that are cleaner. And we can affect both of those things, and we're doing things in both of those areas to improve the situation. I'm going to focus on transit a little bit because, especially my Department of Transportation Services, we run the bus, and we have close connection with HART, who is now building the rail transit project. So I'm going to talk about those a little bit, talk about our other city fleet vehicles, and then talk about generally about transportation, especially our efforts towards bicycle and transportation modes that, again, will. Make those trips greener, or even the trip not taken, ideally, in order to reduce our overall greenhouse gas emissions. And so first, the Honolulu Rail Transit Project. I'm sure many of you realize that it's under construction, scheduled to open partially in 2018 and then completely by 2021. The analysis done for HART does show that it's going to reduce vehicle miles traveled, and it's going to reduce transportation energy demand over time. And then also, in addition to that, it is part of an overall catalyst for creating opportunities for trips that can be greener in general. In other words, creating lifestyles, development around stations that essentially says people don't need to drive as far, don't need to drive at all. And then the vehicles themselves are, of course, electric and use other forms of energy savings technology. Now, in cooperation with HART, the city has got a rail station access program that encourages, again, transit-oriented development opportunities, as well as accessing the stations, the rail stations themselves, so that people can take advantage of this. And the priorities that we have are basically that ideally every single one of the stations should be walkable. That is, the environment around the station, either as you're getting off the station, you walk downstairs, or you're trying to get to the station, that entire environment should be as walkable as possible to encourage that as the primary access to transit. Secondary is bicycling, make a bicycling environment. The two, walking and bicycling, are really the most efficient and the cleanest forms of transportation, and those are the ones that we want to encourage as a connection to transit. Third, getting people to take the bus or to use paratransit to reach rail when they can't, when they're too far to walk or bicycle. Fourth, using automobile or taxi as a drop-off. I'm sorry if the slides didn't come out quite as clean as they should have, but and then finally, park and ride as sort of a fifth and final option. And now, four of the stations do have park and ride opportunities, but frankly, we really hope that people will use other modes instead to reach their destination in the future. So, in light of that, we are. Come on in. we are. Going to be reconfiguring the bus system to provide better access to all of the rail stations, and we have a process in place now of looking at every single one of our bus routes to see how we can make it more efficient once rail does come online. And then the fleet itself, the bus fleet that we have control over, we have almost 550 buses right now, 20% of which are hybrid electrics, which of course reduce fuel consumption, but also reduced emissions and reduced noise. We have a plan in place to increase the in the near term the number of hybrid electric buses that we are that we have in our fleet. But in the long run, we want to move to actually 100% electric, 100% emission-free buses. We submitted a grant idea to the federal government last year for a Tiger grant to use a circulator system from the Ala Moana rail station to Waikiki using 100% emission-free vehicles. And the intention is, now we didn't win that grant, we're actually going to resubmit again this year. I think we did very well, but we didn't quite win. But we've always been saying, even if we don't win, we're still going to move in this direction. And that is, we started partnering with Hawaiian Electric to set up a potential charging station somewhere near the Ala Moana rail station. And the idea will be that as people get off at that particular station, they would hop on a bus that would circulate through Waikiki. And that bus would be completely emission free. So our intention is to begin serving parts of the city with zero emission buses very, very soon. So that's something that is a high priority for us. And as I said, we keep ordering more in the near term, hybrid electric buses, in the long term, moving towards completely 100% emission-free electric buses or some form of electric bus. And then the fleet, other parts of our city fleet, we have been moving in the direction as well. We do have electric vehicles for use by staff. Utility carts are all electric now. We've used almost 1.5 million gallons of biodiesel blend fuel last year. We have a number of electric vehicle charging stations that we've set up. Our trucks are using LPG as well as all of our forklifts. And we have our other vehicles are flex fuel capable. So just as the bus fleet is moving in the direction of 100% emission free, our other vehicles that are controlled by the city and county are moving in that direction as well. And then another thing I always love to mention, because this is one of my favorite parts of what we're doing, what I get to do, is complete streets. And this is a countywide, island-wide effort to make the streets more compatible for all modes, meaning that we want to move in the direction of people being able to walk, being able to bicycle wherever they are. And of course, a good example of a concrete example of our effort has been the protected bike lane that we have installed on King Street. I am happy to report that the number of people bicycling on King Street has shot up by 80% since we installed that. Every time someone chooses to bicycle or walk or hop on a transit vehicle instead of driving their own car, of course, saves fuel, reduces emissions, and gets us closer to the targets that everybody else has been talking about. So these are the kinds of things we're doing. We're very happy with the direction we're headed, but we realize these are, in some cases, you know, minor efforts or considered maybe a drop in the bucket in terms of where we want to go, but still they represent the momentum and the direction that we want to head in our jurisdiction. So with that, I will just say thank you. Mahalo.
It helps, but maybe not.
Thank you, Mark Garrity. You want to take a break? Sharon, you want to take a break at this point? You want to go on? Okay. All right. And by the way, it all evokes in my mind that elevator again in Bishop Square. And there's a bunch of people in the elevator, and all of a sudden in walks an executive in bike clothes. And, you know, it reminds me, Mitch Dolier made a statement in a program we had yesterday on jobs. He said whenever he sees a military guy in Whole Foods there in Kailua, he thanks him for his service to the country. Well, when this bicycle guy comes into the elevator at Bishop Square, a gentle round of applause. That's what we need. We want to encourage him. Okay, you want to talk about the future of clean energy, 100% renewables in the electrical sector. Next panel is really important. They're working on getting us to meet our goal, getting us to 100% renewables by 2045. It's a tall order. It's inherently disruptive. And they're going to tell us what it means, what it'll take, what we have to do, who has to do it to get there. So first is I'm going to call on the administrator of the State Energy Office in DBED, Mark Glick, who is in charge of the state energy policy and oversees the elements all the way from renewable energy to electrical generation to transportation. He'll tell us what this means, what needs to be done right now in this session, looking forward. And then we'll hear from Chris Yunker, the State Energy Office Manager of Energy Systems and Planning. He's going to give us some detail, more detail, on the path we should take and the framework we should build to get to 100%. Chris will be followed with Dr. Rick Rochelot of the Natural Energy Institute, HNEI. We really need to hear from Rick on whether we have what it takes technologically. His cutting-edge research looks at storage, smart grid integration, biofuels, hydrogen, and other technologies. It also addresses the cost of enabling government and industry to bring us together to an affordable, sustainable, clean energy model. We need to listen carefully. Actually, Rick talks very quickly. So that's good. So we can get together on how to stay the course and achieve our goal. Let's see. So the first is Mark Glick. Welcome to the program, Mark Glick.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Jay. And of course, Mike, Sharon, thank you so much for, again, arranging this and having us here. Last year, when Governor Ige signed Hawaii's landmark 100% portfolio standard, he and, of course, the legislature removed any ambiguity whatsoever about where the state's headed with our clean energy transformation. And, you know, by becoming the first state in the nation to make such a bold commitment by day certain, we effectively defined the end state by which we want to achieve and removed all ambiguity about where we're headed. And I can't emphasize enough the importance of an RPS, a firm guiding star to help us plan for action. You know, where are we headed? And we're going to be working very closely this session with the legislature to improve the definitions that the RPS presents a more accurate picture of our renewable energy progress. So Henry and many others, we're going to be reaching out to you on that. Now, as we work to achieve this ambitious goal, it's important that the course we set is guided by some fundamental principles. And, you know, part of it's fairly obvious. We want to favor a diversity of lowest cost solutions without compromising reliability and energy security over the life cycle of infrastructure investments. Now, the State Energy Office is taking a leadership role in this by dockets and engaging our utilities and building a new unprecedented bilateral collaborative planning process to ensure alignment of the state energy policy and utility planning. It's really a holistic approach to optimize investments in the new energy ecosystem to account for the growing interconnected nature of energy consumption. We're trying to get a better sense of the synergies between electricity and transportation sectors. Perhaps most importantly, being able to speak to the utility engineers in a manner that they can understand and with a manner of shared respect and integrity. A key accomplishment of the last 12 months for us has really been building that capacity. We created a new subdivision, the new Energy Systems and Planning Branch. We hired a manager who most recently was brought in from heading up rates and analysis at San Diego Gas and Electric. And more recently, we brought in a senior control systems analyst at Separate Energy to oversee this planning effort and this design of new modeling structures. We also have an engineering support system specialist working on renewable energy deployment, working very closely with our renewable energy branch chief and her team. And again, the whole idea of planning a lot more consistently towards this, our 30% RPS goal in 2020 and the 2045 100% goal. It's a collaborative effort, and much of the heavy lifting will continue to come from Rick Rocheleau and the Hawaii Natural Energy Institute, which has undergone its own capacity building under Rick's leadership. And HNEI has been providing critical thought into the technical challenges presented by the intermittent nature of Hawaii's growing wind and solar renewable energy resources and demand loss from our successful energy efficiency measures. It's been kind of a double-edged sword. We're reducing efficiency basically and creating revenue loss at the utility when it's trying to make all these energy infrastructure investments. Now, when we look to modeling, I'd like to just expand a little bit on what this energy systems and planning branch is doing and the approach in trying to come up with this optimal mix of solutions. It's building models and conducting analysis, taking into consideration fundamental changes in customer needs and varying energy demands and resources with a particular focus on our indigenous renewable energy resources. Chris Junker will talk about that in a moment. You know, when we look at utility reform and innovation, you know, ultimately our active role in a whole number of proceedings, stemming from the Reliability Standards Working Group, the current DER dockets, and of course all the PSIP, DGIP, and all of the other acronyms, all the way up to working on some credible analysis to help guide this merger discussion are all part of the things that we're deeply involved in. But I'd like to talk about one more aspect of Hawaii's clean energy transformation before I close. And that has to do with the energy innovation sector that has the potential to become a significant economic driver as we try to solve some of these environmental problems. Building a supportive environment for this new traded sector will help build the local economy in a myriad of ways. And it tends to bring money into local economies, produce higher wage jobs, diversify the economic base. And obviously, it's a key objective of Director Salaveria and the work at DBED. Marissa Sakuta, a Hawaii Energy Policy Forum alum, is leading the way for us in this area, as well as in building these visualization tools that will help us in the modeling efforts, and it will really help support the work that Energy Systems and Planning Branch and HNEI is doing, as well as all the other critical partners. You're going to hear a lot more of the detail about that from Chris and from Rick in just a moment, but it's an important process, and despite all of the pessimism that we heard before, I'm convinced that we're going to achieve it, just like we've achieved all of our previous goals, in fact, blasted through them We've always done better than the expectation, and we're going to do it again. Thank you.
Okay, next is Chris Yonker. There you are. I know you're there. Thanks for participating in the program. A warm welcome for Chris Yonker.
I'm here today to talk to you a little about the efforts that Energy System and Planning Branch in the Hawaii State Energy Office is doing towards moving towards 100% renewable energy. And one of the focuses of the discussion here today will be essentially the decision framework by which we're looking at getting there. In taking you through some of the critical aspects that we look about in terms of how we go about making decisions to bridge the gap between where we are today and 100% renewable energy, I want to just touch on three critical aspects in my time here. And one is that we need to understand the entire energy ecosystem. Another is that we need to understand what is required to transform our existing energy system to one that can support 100% renewables. And then we also have to take a look at balancing progress with flexibility in terms of meeting our near-term targets while providing for the optimization of a portfolio to achieve 100%. This is one of the charts I love. It's a chart that was put together by Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, and it looks at all the energy resources that are serving Hawaii and tracks them all the way through to the efficiency of their end use. Now, what I'm not going to do today is discuss all the details in the chart, but what I do want to talk about is four things that are highlighted by this chart that the Energy Systems and Planning Branch is delving into deeper when we look at our roadmap to 100%. The first is simply the energy resources themselves that serve Hawaii, and this includes both the renewable resources and the fossil resources, as well as potential renewable resources that could be utilized in the future. The next is how do we deliver that energy to customers? Today, that renewable resource could be channeled through electric generation, electricity, or it could be directly through combustion, like we have in our cars with gasoline, or heating in cooking with fossil fuel and natural gas. But in the future, we also have to look at additional pathways that could come forward from things like hydrogen, which could open up a whole new pathway to deliver renewable energy to customers. Next, we need to look at who's using the energy and how much energy are they using. This is critically important in looking at the opportunities of transitioning fossil fuel use to renewable energy. And last, we want to look at the efficiency of that energy use. Energy efficiency has been a cornerstone of Hawaii energy policy for forever. But what this allows us to do by looking at the entire energy ecosystem is understand the dynamics in the interrelationship. What does it mean when we talk about decarbonizing the transportation sector? Or what happens when we talk about replacing a resource such as petroleum with renewable energy? And so, in short, the chart gets down to is what energy resources are currently used and what renewable resources are available, how energy is delivered to customers today and tomorrow, and who is using energy, how much they are using, and how efficient is that energy use. The next thing that I want to talk about that we take into consideration when we're developing this plan is transitioning our existing energy system. And Rick Rocheleau will go into much greater detail in terms of the requirements of these different types of strategies. But what I want to talk about here is in the decision framework, what are some of the drivers that would guide us in developing our plan? This is just a couple, there are many. But one of the things is, what's the capacity that we need for down ramp and up ramp? And that generally is just talking about, if you look at the net demand, which is the yellow, how much capacity do we have to have in place so that we can fluctuate that meet that grid reliability by turning down resources and turning them back up to meet those demands. And one of the reasons that's a driver, because if you look at the must-run generation, and that's that blue and that green, those ramps, one of the big considerations and one of the big drivers of that capacity in place right now is that ramp. And so we have to have that in place. So in the near term, we have to figure out, you know, what do we need in place for that? But then also to get to 100%, at some point we're going to need to make a decision on when to replace that with another type of resource. Another cost driver is when we look at is curtailment or storage. When we get to a point where we have renewables in excess of that net demand, we're going to have to make decisions on how to integrate those things. And one of those things is storage, or another strategy is curtailment. But these are just a couple of the considerations that we need to do when we're putting together that roadmap, once again, to get from where we are today to 100%. So once again, what was there was just simply, we need to look at the cost drivers in transforming the existing energy system. And we need to take these cost drivers into account when we're looking at the combination of renewable and integration strategies that currently exist to get us to our near-term targets, but they're also cost drivers that we need to take into account when looking at what's available to get to 100%. The last thing I'd like to walk through is a little bit around the flexibility that's required and the need to meet our near-term targets. There are plenty of ways that we can do this. You know, we can get to our near-term targets of 30 and 40% and get to and preserve the flexibility of getting to 100% renewables under a number of different options. And Rick will talk to this again, but up here is just an illustrative mix of renewables that gets us to 30%. You know, we can do it in any number of ways, but what shows below is speaks to that cost drivers that I just talked about in terms of integration, be it through curtailment or storage, and the ramping requirements that are made. What I'm going to talk about next is essentially how our choices, when we start moving beyond this 30% to move to 70 and 100%, are going to change those cost drivers. And the real takeaway right now is that we can no longer simply compare renewables on a dollar per megawatt hour basis. We have to look at renewables in terms of the dollar per megawatt hour cost of the renewable resource, as well as the cost of the supporting grid that needs to be there to enable that 100%. So I'm just going to show a few different ways that we can get there, and it'll highlight, if you look at the bottom chart, which shows about 3 days, how those cost drivers change depending upon the mix of renewables. So if we have a high level of base, or oh, this is the first one, is high level of intermittent renewables that we have in place today. So we had a lot of storage, we had a lot of wind and a lot of solar, and then we look at, okay, there's going to be a significant increase in the amount of storage or curtailment that we need to have in place and the ramping requirements in order to balance that out. So we need to look at those resources in combination with that. When we look at the cost of a more of a base-loaded type renewable, say geothermal, we can see once again the difference in the movements of those drivers, be it the ramping, be it the storage and the integration. So once again, it's not just a direct one-to-one comparison. We need to look at both the energy resource and the grid cost when we make these decisions. We also need to think about the fact that there could be some technological breakthroughs. Actually, there will be technological breakthroughs. So we need to be prepared and have the flexibility to deal with that. There could be things like ocean thermal or new biotech technologies that come through that really make it commercially scalable at a level where we can supply a lot of our renewable resources. But if you look at that, all of these change the level of the grid requirements and will change the types of things that we need to do and the strategies that we deploy to get to 100%. So once again, we need to understand what resources are available today that can get us to the near-term RPS targets. We need to maintain the flexibility and to adjust to technological innovations and changes in the market pricing of both the energy resources, but the grid technologies. And we also, looking forward, those transformational investment decisions, especially going beyond the 30 and 40%, we need to consider both the energy and the grid cost and make a holistic approach in making our decisions. And right now we're really looking at the electric sector, but as some, you know, you've heard Ben talk about before, The state is really looking at that entire picture, the holistic approach in the ground transportation, because ultimately we're looking to get off of fossil fuels. So we need to take the entire system into perspective. So with that, from energy systems and planning, we are committed to developing a robust roadmap to getting to 100% renewables. We are developing the tools and we're building the staff that is capable of analyzing what is an increasingly interdependent and dynamic energy system. And we are partnering with stakeholders, both locally and nationally, such as HNEI, to explore new analytical tools and analyze resources and leverage our resources and share experiences so that we can develop a robust roadmap to get from where we are today to 100% renewables. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. The operative word, dynamic and moving target. Your work is cut out for you. Dr. Rick Rochelot, our energy tech hero, who makes it all possible with this great technology, creating a worldwide reputation. Thank you so much for coming down, Rick. A warm welcome for Rick Rochelot.
Thank you. And even if I talk as fast as Jay accuses me of, I can't come close to meeting everything that Mark and Chris set me up for. So I'm going to have to narrow that down just a little bit. Is this going to get me there if I do it? Okay. I was assigned to kind of talk about how we get to the 100%. And I think what I'm going to do is probably, as I usually do, kind of put a couple of words of caution in terms of kind of maintaining that diversity of the resource and diversity of the plan that we just heard about it and how we put that path together. So I want to move along pretty quick. So, you know, in the past we've talked a lot this systems modeling we're doing at GE and gone through the process and what it is, and it's very similar to what Chris is doing. Other people, Matthias Fripp from the university, have various models. I think what sets us apart right now is that while we've been doing this for quite a while and really put together a good team, we also have incorporated a lot of other stakeholders into the process. So we have DBED, the Public Utilities Commission, utility, independent energy producers, looking at the models, looking at the data, looking at the assumptions. And I think this is a really important thing going forward. There's a lot of commonality in the models, but you can pretty much go anywhere you want depending on what you put in. So coming together to agree on some of the basic numbers are going to help us narrow down a little bit on what we can and can't do and what makes sense. So that's kind of, I've shown that graph in the middle before, that's kind of the overall process similar to what other people are doing. Previous studies, we really showed that, you know, with utility making changes that they're currently making, reducing, you know, min runs and a lot of what they do in their systems, there are pathways to 40% renewables, wind and solar. If you got geothermal and biomass, those are extra. Those are dispatchable. So you can add that on top. But 40% wind and solar pathways, but those are all mixed resources. It's a little difficult if it's really solar dominant. I'm going to kind of touch on a couple of things about that. And going forward, as we get above that 40% number, you start to see curtailment go up sharply, whether it's wind and solar together or solar dominant. And so we're going to have to really take a new look at integrating with transportation, bringing in the new technology, really diversifying the way we do things. So same message Chris had, we really need to really expand what we do across the limit of things. So I'm going to really focus down on one thing. I'm going to look at, and I don't quite go to 100, you know, I'm a conservative engineer, so I'm only going to go to 70% renewables from wind and solar. So the other 30% can come from waste and from biofuels and everything else. So imagine it's 100%, but we're 70% wind and solar for sake of argument. And what we did, just to put kind of real numbers in this, I'm really going to look at how do we integrate solar and what's some of the difficulty on integrating wind and solar to these high numbers. So I said, let's look about where we're going to be at the end of this year. And we're going to have roughly 400 megawatts of distributed PV on the rooftops, uncontrolled, 125 megawatts of wind if the last little 25 increments gets fully permitted, and there's 150 megawatts of central solar. Sounds like a lot. In the middle of the day, that's about 675 megawatts on a load that's under 1,000, but that's only 16% of Oahu's energy use. So getting to 40, 50, 60, 70 is a huge amount more. And in fact, if you look below, we're kind of looking at three scenarios. We're saying, let's start there, let's add solar only, let's add wind only, or let's add a mix. And if I look at the wind as an example, I would need 1,600 more megawatts of wind at about a 40% capacity factor. That's 800 more wind turbines, the size of what we have on the North Shore. So it's a formidable task when you start putting numbers on these things in terms of what we need. So what do we do here? We projected up to that much, not all the scenarios are that high. We said, let's put storage in there to see what storage can do. We created a real simple storage model. We said, if we have excess energy and there's capacity in the battery, put it in the battery. And if we can put energy out of the battery back onto the grid without violating reserve requirements, let's do it. So it's really kind of an optimistic look at how much energy can you arbitrage using storage for different scenarios. And then we tried to get an idea of the cost of that. Three slides. So the first one's a general look at what is the curtailment at high penetrations. And the axis doesn't go to zero, so it's a little bit misleading. But basically, there's a couple of points. One is that the curtailment So the curtailment's obviously, it's a function of what the resource mix is. And it's interesting. Solar stands out by itself, and wind and wind is the 50-50 mix kind of track along pretty similarly. The other thing is, once we get to fairly high penetration levels, as you would expect, the incremental curtailment goes up drastically. Your ability to get it on without curtailment goes down a lot. So those dots correspond as you go across to 20, 30, 40, or 30, 40, 50, 60, and 70%. Once you're up at about 40% total renewables on that grid, you put more solar on and you're almost 100% curtailed unless you're doing something else. You're going to need a lot of storage. Doesn't mean you can't do some load shifting and put EVs, and we've got to go back and look at everything. For this, I just wanted to take a snapshot look at solar. And what I'm going to do now is come back to the 60% line and say, let me look at that, and let me compare solar for the wind and for the, look at storage for the solar and the wind scenario. And I leave the mix out because it turns out it behaves a lot like the wind in all cases, and it makes the plots a little simpler. So, one of the things, I mean, there's a lot of discussion about intermittency of the renewable resources, and a lot of it shows the daytime, you know, it goes up and then it fluctuates, you know, with some fairly high frequency fluctuation, it comes down at night. Wind can do that at all different times, and the utility needs to address that. But I think a bigger factor in integrating storage into the grid is the fact that the resource itself is, total resource day to day is very variable. I mean, there's days we have absolutely no wind, and there's days we have raging trade winds all day. And so trying to integrate storage to capture that excess energy is very difficult. The plot on the left shows for the 60% scenarios, wind, solar, and mixed, how much curtailed their energy there would be by day for the year that we modeled, looking at hour by hour dispatch. And what you find is that, as you'd expect, solar goes from high to low. The left axis is gigawatt hours per day curtailed. You know, it goes from pretty high on a really solid sunny day when everything's working and is a model of a distributed arrays and central arrays across the island, down to the days it's really cloudy and there's almost nothing. Wind is even worse. I mean, there's some days where there's absolutely no wind, and when the days when it's really blowing, it can blow for all 24 hours, so you end up with a lot of curtailed energy. So if you kind of put a horizontal line across there anywhere, you know, with a certain number of gigawatt hours, you can easily see that some days your battery's not going to be big enough to capture, you know, the higher ones, and on other days you're not going to have enough to fill your battery. So your battery's going to be underutilized, and part of the question is by how much. Another issue is those days tend to get clustered. I mean, wind in particular, but and it's pretty random. But, you know, fronts come through and the wind will blow really solid. You know, trade winds blow and it blows for a month. Well, if I'm at a high wind scenario and the wind blows for a month, I fill my battery. I still have curtailed wind every hour of the day. I have nowhere to dump it. So now I've got battery sitting there and there's nowhere it can go. Same thing if it's cloudy for a bunch of days in a row. How do we get to it? So that impacts our use of the battery. The graph on the right shows for different battery sizes how much we can increase the delivered energy to the grid for the 60% profile. And what you find is, in spite of the fact that there's a lot of wind that we can capture, it's almost flat. No matter how big a battery you put in, we don't capture very much wind. On the solar one, at the kind of the smaller size batteries, you use them pretty effectively. As you get bigger, they don't. At the 60%, we're looking at about 20% curtailed for the wind and 42% for the solar. Thank you. So, real quick, what do I have left? Two slides. Okay. Let's get an idea of the cost of this, and I'm going to have to go through this pretty quick. Let me look at an idealized cost of a battery. How much is this going to add? I've got curtailed energy. I got to pay for my system. Now I got to go pay for that energy again by capturing it in solar and putting it back on the grid. Let me assume the battery, kind of I define 100% utilization, could be more in a day, is I cycle that thing as full capacity once a day and then put it back on the grid that same day. If I had a 1 gigawatt hour battery, it reduced curtailment by 365 gigawatt hours a day. If I have different installed costs of those batteries, and I use 250, 500, and 1,000, and I assume basically 10% annual cost recovery, and that's what people use with an 8% cost of capital in 20-year life, that's going to cost me 7, 14, or 28 cents a kilowatt hour for every kilowatt hour I get back on the grid, if I'm at 100%. The reality is the lifetime may not be 20 years. The battery utilization decreases as the capacity goes up. And then round trip efficiency is probably more like 75 to 85%. That changes those numbers by almost a factor of 2 in some cases. And what you see on the left, those little bars, is what those actual utilization factors are for different size batteries on that grid. So basically it says there's a significant incremental cost to using storage and putting it on the grid. And again, you gotta look at the whole system and how it's used, but it doesn't come in free. Now, one of the factors that we see a lot of, and I'm gonna get dinged here and I'm still not getting, we see a lot of very low cost estimates of batteries for cost. A lot of those are the battery cells only. You put them in a system, you integrate them into the grid, you add the inverter and you do the installation, and those numbers go up a lot. This next slide is, here's three pictures from a 1 megawatt battery that we're installing down at the HECO site with a lot of help from HECO to get it installed. That cost isn't gonna go away no matter what you do on your battery. So you could argue you're gonna be in the $300 to $500 range just based on these kinds of numbers right here. Okay, my conclusion, I'm gonna go with two. We gotta get back, we gotta really open it up again, we gotta integrate things to look at a wide range of scenarios, we gotta get some agreement about our assumptions of what we're doing. And the second one is, it's great to use forward-looking cost projections for planning, but we've got to use real numbers to make our decisions now. Thank you.
Absolutely. This is the kind of analysis we have to make. And hearing you, Rick, it sounds like we're closer and closer to actually getting there. That's fabulous. Sharon, you want to take a break now? You want to go straight through?
3 minutes, yeah.
Okay.
And get the panel up.
All right. Why don't we have the next panel come up? The next panel is Amina Morita, Dawn Lippert, and Darren Okimoto. Why don't you take a seat up with a microphone? The changes and challenges ahead will be constant, but our commitment cannot waver. We know this goal will not be achieved in a year or two, but if we concentrate, we may well be able to do it before 2045, maybe early. Wouldn't that be great? Let's do it together. We need big picture thinking. A systems integrated approach that watches and deploys the newest technology and the best practices. So we've seen mistrust, we've seen self-seeking, we've seen profiteering and silos and kulianas and PR spins, antagonism, conflict, but aloha must prevail. A new and different perspective must be addressed. We talk a good game, but we have to find ways to work together and get it done. Hopefully our third panel now can help us do that. We'll start the panel off with Mina Morita, followed by Dawn Lippert, and then Darren Okimoto. For flexibility, I'll just introduce them now, and they can jump in when appropriate. Mina Morita is no stranger. She is the former House Energy and Environmental Committee Chair, the PUC Chair, and now a consultant, energy consultant, and serious blogger on energy dynamics. That's the name of the blog, and is working with the forum to bring us together as we work to stay the course. We want her to go beyond any particular technology, project, or Kuliana, and put everything together at the 50,000-foot level so we can see the path and the obstacles to the future. Second is Don Lippert. Don Lippert is a very ambitious and hardworking director of Hawaii Energy Accelerator, a program under PICTR, Pacific Information Center for High Technology Research. She's been nurturing energy entrepreneurs in Hawaii and abroad for some time to bring us to the most innovative energy infrastructure in Hawaii. Okay, am I going one by one or all three? All three, okay. And Darren Ogimoto. While not usually in our energy space, we're also pleased to have Darren Ogimoto, Associate Director of the Sea Grant College Program at Manoa, which itself is a partnership with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA. Sea Grant helps academia, federal, state, academic, federal, state, and local government, industry, local communities understand and steward coastal and marine resources. He's no stranger to working in partnership with many agencies. Just what we need in clean energy, he can tell us to get the job done. So let's start out with Mina Morita. A warm welcome from Mina Morita.
Good afternoon. You know, Jay talked about the, is it 50,000 foot level? But when it all comes down, it's about engaging the community and various stakeholders. And, you know, that's the challenge of our efforts to achieve this transformation. So we all know that for more than a decade, the energy sector has been the core of Hawaii's clean energy transformation, driven primarily by high electricity prices and the amount of money being exported out of state for oil. Today, as we have a better understanding, and as you've heard earlier, of the interrelationship and the interconnectedness between energy, water, climate change, food production, natural resource management, and economic opportunities, just to name some of the few connections, to become more sustainable. How we tackle these long-term and complex challenges with limited resources will take innovation, collaboration, and partnerships. And as we move forward with Hawaii's clean energy transformation, every aspect of our lives will be touched. How we live, work, and play, how we think and use and talk about energy, how we plan, innovate, and execute to achieve this transformation will be required. So we need some successful models out there to take on these complex issues and needed for this forward progress. So I want to turn it over to Don and Darren to talk about their roles, activities, and outreach to address the must-haves for clean energy transformation, integration, innovation, collaboration, and partnerships. So, thanks.
Great. Thanks, Nina. Thanks. So, has anyone in this room not heard of the Energy Accelerator? Should I explain what we do? Okay, great. We're among friends. So now I'd actually like you to raise your hand if you've ever talked to an Energy Accelerator company or are partnering with one of our companies or in some way sort of supporting the innovation ecosystem. Okay, great. That's about two-thirds of you. If you're in the other third, you should come talk to me after this. We'll get you involved. Don't worry. I want to start by talking a little bit about the climate discussion we had earlier, and also what that means for Hawaii and our place in it. And there's a couple things in particular I think that are important for where Hawaii goes, particularly around Mina's comments around partnership and innovation. So one thing that people may not know about what happened in Paris and the Paris Agreement is that as part of that agreement, something happened called Mission Innovation, which is a commitment that Bill Gates and Mark Zuckerberg and Benioff and many of the other sort of billionaires in the tech space and sort of around the world made to investing in clean energy innovation. And the commitment they made was $20 billion over the next few years invested in clean energy innovation. So that's basically an order of magnitude above what we've invested in the last couple of years in energy innovation. And what that means to us as an innovation program, and I think as a state, is that we need to figure out a way to get Hawaii on the path of that amount of resources and that money. The path to 100% clean energy around the world has to go through Hawaii. And I think what we're doing on the innovation side is particularly looking at how to do that. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples. And I also want to talk about, I mean, part of what happened in Paris also was this debate around, should we invest in clean energy research and development, or should we invest in clean energy deployment? And there's sort of an ongoing debate about those two things. And what happened in Paris, sort of those two questions coming together and saying that we actually need clean energy deployment in order to fund research and development and innovation. And what we're doing in Hawaii, I think, is seeing where innovation and deployment meet. So it's a very unique place to be in, and I think we have to own that space and make sure that we can really capitalize on that as a community. So a couple of updates on the companies that we've funded. We're funding about 15 companies a year now in energy storage, energy efficiency, and electricity generation, also in transportation, water, ag, et cetera. And I want to give you a few numbers about where those projects are, and many of them are in partnership with the work that you folks have done also. So STEM, our distributed battery company, I mean, Rick talked a lot about energy storage and small, big, how does that work? They're right now deploying energy systems and turning on 4 more this month. Shifted is our company that does grid interactive water heating. So we're working with Hawaiian Electric on that one as well. They're a really critical partner. They're deploying grid interactive water heaters across the west side, so number on the west side, and they have 200 tanks that are now under control in the grid interactive water heating space. So that's basically a way to help use water heaters as a resource. One of our companies, a local homegrown company, Ibis Networks, just deployed in 3 schools with the Department of Education, so using their little plug to monitor and control devices at schools and kind of help with some of the Cool Schools Initiative and how we bring AC into the schools while also making sure that they stay energy efficient and we don't blow our energy budgets on AC. Bidgely is one of our companies that does really interesting energy efficiency at the home level, and they've started their alpha pilot just last month installing a number of different homes here in Hawaii, and they have a really interesting technology. You basically have one device that goes on the home, and through your mobile phone you can see exactly where all the energy is going, and you can look from your phone and basically disaggregate use on energy, and they give you little tips like, oh hey, look, your fridge is open, stuff like that. If you want to be in on any of these pilots, we are deploying technology at many of your homes already. On our team, Jill is our tester. She puts all the technology in her house and figures out how it all works, so she's got all of this stuff in there interacting. But if you want any of this in your home to test it out, let me know. One of our companies, FreeWire, has a really cool robot where they basically take Second Life Nissan Leaf batteries and put them on a robot platform, and you can go around and charge, do EV charging without doing trenching in parking lots, large market for kind of condos and multifamily homes. They're looking for additional pilot site for 3 more units to do that. And our company, Terviva, which is one of our agriculture companies, has planted now over 50 acres on the North Shore in partnership with Kamehameha Schools. And their crop is an oil seed crop that you can then press and make raw oil for energy, but also make feed for cattle feed. So kind of addressing some of our agricultural challenges. So those are 6 of the 32 companies that we're working with. Next week, we're going to announce another 11 companies and 8 demonstration projects that we're funding this year. So there's a lot of momentum in this space around people wanting to do innovation in Hawaii and some of the really exciting things they're doing. These companies have also created over 200 jobs, and many of those jobs are right here in Hawaii, and you know those folks that are working there. So this is a really important economic development opportunity for the state and a really growing sector. I'll give you a little preview into one of the companies that we're going to be announcing next week, and this is actually a company that came about through a conversation with Ray and Caroline over at Hawaii Energy, which was, they said, you know, one of the really difficult to address markets is restaurant efficiency. So when we were out there recruiting companies across the nation, looking at hundreds of companies, we started looking for companies in the restaurant efficiency space. So next week, one of the companies we'll be announcing is a company that has a really innovative solution for working in mostly fast food restaurants that have really razor-thin margins, and energy is a big problem for them. So we're excited about that and about solving additional problems here that we see in the state. So on that note, I just want to mention that we are looking for more companies this year, about 15 more companies. We need more Hawaii companies in that pipeline. So if there are people that you know at the university or sort of across our communities that are starting companies, please have them apply to us. We have a new person on our team who's handling a lot of that pipeline work and also working on international partnerships. And so she's here today. Ramsey, if you can raise your hand. So she joined us, and she'll be taking in a lot of those new companies. And on the international partnership side, I also want to mention that just last week we announced a partnership with New Zealand. And this one actually came about through an introduction from Hawaiian Electric Industries, because the biggest energy provider in New Zealand said, You know, we want to partner with Hawaii. We want to figure out how to deploy technology. They're a really innovative company. They've partnered with Tesla. They've partnered with BMW, with Mini on a number of different sort of technology plays. And we'd like to partner with Hawaii. We'd like to learn from you guys. They're about twice as big as us in terms of energy customers. So we're partnering with them and taking a lot of the lessons learned that we've done here, a lot of things that, you know, HNEI and those folks have done, and working on deploying those in New Zealand as well, and kind of learning from each other, which is really exciting for us, and I hope there'll be more good announcements about Asia Pacific this year. Lastly, I want to mention is kind of what 2016 looks like. We've been working with the State Energy Office a lot on a number of these projects and kind of moving forward innovation, integrating it into the state's overall energy plan, so that innovation is actually helping solve problems and is not just something that's, you know, nice to have and sort of more on the economic development side, but it's completely integrated into our energy system. So we've been working with Mark in his office on that. In 2016, we'd like to see more companies in cybersecurity, water, and agriculture. So if there are folks coming to you guys, I know a lot of companies are coming to, you know, talk to the State Energy Office, talk to the university, talk to the counties about what they want to do. Feel free to send those guys our way. And then the last thing that I think we're looking for 2016 is to continue to close the gap between policy and technology. So, you know, we see a lot of interesting technology that doesn't yet have kind of the rate structures and the policy to deploy and make business models work. So that's something that we're continuing to work a lot with the state on, and how we set up demand response programs correctly, how we set up rate structures correctly, and how we kind of are responsive enough in the policy sphere to what's happening in technology. I think we're actually way ahead of where the rest of the country is on this. I mean, in general, policy tends to lag technology, you know, quite a bit, and I think that we have a smaller gap here in Hawaii, but we still have work to do. So that's what I see on the horizon for 2016. And all of these pieces require partnerships. So all of the companies that we work with, and all of the progress that we've made in innovation, all of it requires partnerships with hotels, with landowners, with our energy stakeholders in the state. So again, I just want to thank everyone in this room for the work that you've done making this innovation stuff possible, and really putting Hawaii on that path of kind of capital and momentum moving into innovation in 2016. Thanks.
Okay, so last but not least. My name is Darren Okimoto. I serve as the Associate Director and Extension Leader for the University of Hawaii Sea Grant College Program. Oops. There. Okay, great. And would like to start by just thanking Mina for the opportunity to come and present at today's Hawaii Energy Policy Forum. And today's talk, you know, by the end of my presentation, what I hope to demonstrate is how Sea Grant actually demonstrates these characteristics of integration, innovation, and cooperation, and how our position is well, and how our program is well positioned to actually address the energy, water, climate, and other types of priority needs that our coastal communities are facing. So this slide shows our mission statement for the University of Hawaii Student College Program. I'm not going to read the statement to you, but what I do want to emphasize is that there are actually, for any Sea Grant program to meet its mission, there are three core activities that it conducts. It conducts research, extension, and education activities that are really designed to deliver the latest scientific information that's generated at the university that provides our stakeholders the opportunity to make informed decisions on, say, the management of coastal and marine resources. Our program has actually five areas in which we focus or concentrate our, say, research, extension, and education activities. And these are indigenous cultural heritage, water resource sustainability, sustainable coastal development, hazard resilience in coastal communities, and sustainable coastal tourism. Each of these yellow dots represents the location of a state Sea Grant College program. Throughout the national network, there are 33 programs nationwide, and they are mostly based at universities in coastal and Great Lakes states, and also two U.S. territories that include Puerto Rico and Guam. Now, the majority of our program's work actually is focused in the state of Hawaii, But we also have extension agents out in American Samoa. So for example, we have one agent who's based at the American Samoa Community College in American Samoa, and also another that is based at the College of the Marshall Islands in the Marshall Islands, and a third extension agent who is based at an NGO in Ponape in the Federated States of Micronesia. So how do we achieve our mission? So basically one word, partnerships. It's all about partnerships and leveraging resources. So C-Grant, what we try to do is form these effective strategic partnerships with a variety of different stakeholders, for example, that we list here, and basically leveraging these resources to provide the best scientific information possible so these stakeholders can make informed decisions on the management of their resources. This slide is a representative sample of the various types of organizations that we partner with. So as you scan the list, one of the things I hope you take home with you is that we formed through our 48 years of existence through our program, you know, a variety of different partnerships at all different levels, you know, at the local level, state, the federal, the national level, and even internationally. Now, of those three activities, the really key one to me, in my opinion, you know, being the extension leader, has to be extension. Because what extension does really is serve as this conduit for two-way information transfer. So we have 36 extension faculty that basically take the knowledge that is generated at the university, translate that knowledge, and disseminate that to our coastal stakeholders, who in turn then can make informed decisions about the management of their resources. Our extension faculty, who also live, work, and play in these communities, you know, are able then to identify what these priority needs and issues are, and then take that information and then transfer that information back to university researchers to inform, say, the direction of their research activities. Our program is actually organized around what we're calling centers of excellence. Currently, we have three centers. Our longest standing center is the Center for Smart Building and Community Design, and is led by Professor Steve Meter, who is a professor in architecture. The second center that we have is the Center for Marine Science Education, and this is a partnership with the College of Education, and this center is led by Dr. Kanisa Serafin, and she's an associate professor in the Curriculum Research and Development Group. And then our third center is the Center for Sustainable Coastal Tourism. This center is led by Dr. Denise Conan, who is a professor of economics and also the dean of the College of Social Sciences. Now, just last week, we had our C-Grant Advisory Board meeting, which Mina was able to attend, and we announced the creation of this new center of excellence, which is the Institute for Hawaiian Language Research and Translation. So this center actually is led by Dr. Marvin Puakea-Nogemeyer, who is a professor in Hawaiian language, and as maybe many of you might be aware, is the voice of the bus. And so this center actually developed because of a longstanding collaboration that we had with Puakea on working on a project involving the translation of Hawaiian language newspapers. So why these centers of excellence? Why does C-Grant utilize these centers? Well, for one thing, what these centers do is they give us a template or framework for organizing all of our research, extension, and education activities. By their very nature, these centers also promote collaboration across the university and allow us to tap into additional expertise outside of C-Grant so that we can bring those different expertises to bear on the coastal issues that we're trying to address. And then finally, as I mentioned a few slides earlier, now, these centers really serve as a vehicle or mechanism for this two-way information knowledge transfer. About 4 to 5 years ago, the former UH Manoa Chancellor, Virginia Hinshaw, instituted this university-wide hiring initiative in sustainability. So C-Grant was one of 16 proposals that were submitted and were given the award. So the net result is that we hired 7 new tenure track faculty over the past 3 years, and these faculty are listed here. And each of these faculty have 3/4 of their position in their home departments and 1/4 of their position in C-Grant, which is dedicated to doing outreach. Now the partnership with the home departments include oceanography, civil and environmental engineering, economics, urban and regional planning, and natural resources and environmental management, as well as the School of Architecture. So these faculty actually are conducting interdisciplinary research on issues related to coastal sustainability. One effective means that we found for leveraging our extension resources is by actually placing or seconding our extension faculty in our partner organizations. So starting from the top left, we have two extension faculty, Brad Romine and Andy Bolander, who seconded to Sam Lemelshop in the Office of Conservation and Coastal Lands in the Department of Land and Natural Resources, where they serve as technical consultants to state planners. We also have two faculty, Tara Owens and Ruby Papp, who are seconded to planning departments in Maui and Kauai, where they provide similar services as well to county planning staffers. On the far right-hand side, we have six extension faculty who are placed at the Hanuma Bay Nature Preserve, which is a city park run by the Parks and Recreation Department. And in this case, our faculty, what they do is they administer the Hanuma Bay Education Program to nearly 800,000 visitors annually. Now, on the bottom of the slide, we have three extension faculty who are seconded to institutions of higher learning in Hawaii and out in the Pacific region. So starting from the left, we have Carl Falenis, who's seconded to the College of the Marshall Islands. In the middle, we have Tara Owens, who's based at Maui College. And then far right, we have Kelly Anderson Tagarino, who's based at the American Samoa Community College. So in addition to conducting outreach activities, these faculty also provide teaching services. Now, in the remaining time that I have, what I wanted to do is just highlight three examples of selected partnerships that we have. So this first partnership is a partnership through the Center for Smart Building and Community Design, and is a partnership actually with Rick Shop, HNEI, and also with the School of Architecture. And so what are listed here, which I won't read, are research projects that the center has been conducting that are related, that are being done at the building scale to improve building performance and design. And one of the other neat things about this project itself is that they involve student training. So students are able to go in and get really on-the-job, hands-on training experience that really prepares them to be more competitive in the job market. The second partnership that I would like to talk about is something that is associated with our Center for Sustainable Coastal Tourism, and has to do with this newly created nonprofit called the Waikiki Beach Special Improvement District Association. So this nonprofit basically was created to handle this fund that was created by the city and county and the mayor, Caldwell, last year, that created a new tax district in Waikiki. And so basically, the property taxes that are collected from the landowners there in Waikiki are being used to exclusively support the management of beach resources in Waikiki. So our role here with the association is that we create an extension agent position that is filled by Dolan Eversall to serve as the coordinator for this particular project in managing Waikiki's beach resources. And then the final project that I would like to highlight involves the Sea Grant Network project, where in 2007, Dennis Wong, who's one of our extension faculty, created this publication called the Homeowner's Handbook to Prepare for Natural Hazards. And so this handbook really was created as a way to provide in one location all of the emergency preparedness information and all of the shelter information, and then how homeowners can actually retrofit their homes against hurricanes and, say, earthquakes. And so this is an idea that resonated greatly with the rest of the Sea Grant Network. So currently we have seven other state Sea Grant programs that had created their own versions of the handbook. And then just last year, we also added Guam and the Republic of the Marshall Islands as well. And with that, I want to just thank you for your time. Mahalo.
Thank you, Darren.
Thank you, Jay.
Thank you, John.
I think the message there is that, 2016 is the year of collaboration. It's the year of making partnerships. It's the year of looking across to the other guy and getting him out of his silo, making deals together, you know, and maybe that's part of our historical transformation now, this year, to touch everyone. It reminds me of what we find at the university in general, is you can't do science without collaborating all over the world. And every scientist you talk to is in touch with you know, hundreds really of other science, and these fantastic conferences that come to Hawaii, such as the Pacific Telecommunications Conference this week, involving thousands of high-level people who talk to each other and cannot do their work unless they collaborate. And I suggest to you that energy cannot do its work unless we collaborate. So this is a year of collaboration. Why don't we do that? Make a call, give your card, make a deal, make a partnership all over town, okay? Not just the university, but everybody. Okay, a big mahalo to all the speakers today. Please give them all a big round of applause. Thank you all for being here, for being committed to our state of clean energy. And give yourself, I guess you did give yourself a round of applause, to one more for yourself, for everybody, for this briefing, for this whole institution that goes on how many years. Mahalo to the House Sergeant-at-Arms Office, Jiran Oyama, and the staff at Olelo, to David Jones of ThinkTech, who are videotaping this, and to our terrific volunteers and students who made it possible. Now, one of the things, see the Toyota Mirai, it's here, the hydrogen-powered fuel cell vehicle on display near the Father Damien statue. It has a range of over 300 miles and can be recharged in 5 minutes. Yes, 5 minutes. And if you get into the elevator at Bishop Square and tell the people there that you're going to get a hydrogen Mirai, they will all give you a round of gentle applause. Don't forget that the Forum and ThinkTech present a live stream video program called Hawaii, the State of Clean Energy, every Wednesday at 4 p.m., where we hope you will keep current on developments in clean energy. You can watch our live stream on thinktechhawaii.com and YouTube. Final point before you go, and while I'm on it, how about a big plug for energy efficiency? We've saved over $12 billion over the past 6 years through Hawaii Energy's incentives and energy savings hints. Check out the Negawatt Moment every Wednesday on thinktechhawaii.com. No matter what we do to achieve 100% clean energy in Hawaii, the efficiency is by far the most cost-effective way to reach our energy goals. Every kilowatt hour that we eliminate through efficiency is one less kilowatt hour that we have to make with costly fossil or even renewable energy. So when we begin and end